So, good morning student. So, in last classes we finished polarizations. Today we will discuss about the diffractions. So, what exactly is the diffraction? So, I am explaining the diffraction by a simple example. Suppose I have a this blade, razor blade, and light is incident on this razor blade, then the incident light will be bent at this space. This light will be bent at this space. Okay, so I can say the bending of the light, the bending at these positions, the bending of the light at the obstacle is known as the diffraction. Right? I have one more example. Suppose I have a ball and light is incident on this ball. So this light will be seen by observer which is behind of this ball from this point to this point. That means the light is bent at point A and at point B. So we can say the bending of the light is known as the diffractions. We can summarize the definition in such a manner that when wave encounter obstacle, they bend round the edge of the obstacle. The bending of the wave around the edge of obstacle is called the diffractions. Simple meaning, the bending of the light is the diffractions. Right. So, what is main difference between interference and diffractions? As you know about the interference, when we talk about the interference, at least we require two sources. So I can say interference is the resultant of interaction of two light sources. Means suppose I have two light sources S1 and S2. The light which is come out from the source S1 and the light which is come out from the source S2 will be superimposed and produce interference light. So this is the interference light. That means we require two or more sources. Why in the diffraction, the interaction of the light is coming from a different part of the same source. Now we have the same source. In this case, we have the same source, but from the different part of the, this source, the interaction is known as a diffraction. Second point, in interference, fringes may or may not be the same width. Fringes may or may not be the same width. Fringes means these are the fringes. So these fringes may be same or not the same in an interference, but in diffractions, they are not same, always different. Some more thickness, another some more thickness, and so on. So they are not same. While in the interference, they may be or may not be the same. Yes, in interference, the center of the minimum region of the minimum intensity is perfectly dark. This is a minima intensity, then this will be the perfectly dark regions in an interference. While in diffractions, it's not a perfectly dark, maybe some bright, but it's not a perfectly dark. And the last point, in an interference, all bright bands are the same intensity. Suppose this is the dark, next one is the bright. Let's I denote by the B, again it's a dark. Then one more bright. Then all bright has the same intensity. Intensity remain same in an interference. While in diffractions, different maxima are of a varying intensity. We have a different maxima. Suppose the maxima of the first ring, maxima of the second, maxima of the third. So the intensity will be varying in a diffractions. but the intensity remains the same for the bright fringes in an interference. So these are the main differences between the interference and diffraction. Right, so the type of diffractions. So when we say about the type of diffractions, we broadly classify diffraction into the two categories. One is the Fresnel diffractions and another is the von Hagen diffractions. Fresnel diffraction is discovered by scientist Fresnel, while the von Hagen diffraction is discovered by von Hagen. So what are the main differences between the Fresnel and von Hagen diffractions? So let's start. In a Fresnel diffraction, the source of the light and screens are effectively at finite distance. This is important. The source of the light and screen are at a finite distance. So let's start. Suppose this is source of a light, and the diffraction pattern is observed at this screen. This is a screen. So the distance between the source and the screen is finite in a Fresnel diffractions, while in a von Hagen diffractions the source and the screens are effectively maintained at the infinite distance. Infinite distance means what? That means we cannot observe the diffraction at particular distance of a screen from the source. The distance may be infinite. So this is the one important difference between the Fresnel and von Hagen diffraction. Second point is, the Fresnel diffraction does not require any lens for the observations. In Fresnel diffractions, we observe the diffraction patterns in a screen. So right now we do not require any lens for the observation of this diffraction pattern. Why? In the case of von Hagen diffractions, we require two convex lens for the observations of a diffraction pattern, because the diffraction pattern is made up at a distance of infinite. So we require at least two lens for the observation of a von Hagen diffractions. And the last important difference between the Fresnel and von Hagen diffraction is that in a Fresnel diffraction, the incident wavefront is not planar. The meaning is that lens, this is lens, and then it's a source. So the incident wavefront is not planar. That means all our wavefronts, all are not in a plane in a Fresnel diffractions. While in a von Hagen diffraction, the incident wavefront is all wavefronts lie in a one plane, single plane. All are lie in a single plane. So this is three major difference between the Fresnel diffraction and von Hagen diffraction. I summarize all this. The Fresnel diffractions have maintained the finite distance between the source and the screen, while the von Hagen diffractions maintain infinite distance between the source and the screen. For the observation of Fresnel diffractions, we doesn't require any kind of the lens, while we require the lens for the observation of the von Hagen diffractions. And the last difference is that the incident wavefront is not planar in a Fresnel diffractions, while incident wavefront is planar in a von Hagen diffractions. Right, so next is intensity distributions in a diffraction pattern due to the single slits. Now we use the single slit and we calculate the intensity distributions, diffraction intensity distributions due to this single slit. So we start. Right, so let's the intensity distributions for the single slit. Right. So this is the convex lens. Source, light is incident on a convex lens. Lens L, and it's fall on a single slit. Like this is the single slit. This is a single slit. It's L, it's a source. It's fall on a single slit. Let's I define by A and B. This is point A and A. After passing through this single slit, this light again fall on a lens and finally produce diffraction pattern at point P. What is clear? The light coming out from the source fall on the lens L and finally incident on a single slit AB, and after passing through this lens L, it produces diffraction pattern at a point P. This is from the one wavefront. We have the number of the wavefronts. So let's for another wavefront. Light is moving in this direction, and after passing through the lens, it's come at the point P prime. And it's produced interference, diffraction pattern at point P prime. Let's the angle, this angle is theta. The new angle is theta. This is theta. This angle is theta. Let's the width. Width of slit AB is equals to A. This is the width of a slit. AB is equals to A. The width. And angle ABL, this angle ABL, this point L, A equals to theta. This angle is theta, right? So my path difference will be equals to A sine theta. The path difference will be A sine theta. We already discussed about the path difference. So if this width is A, then the path difference will be A sine theta. Right. So now we derive a formula of the intensity at point P and P prime. So for the derivation of intensity at point P and P prime, we use vibrational polygons techniques. So I am using vibrational polygon technique for the intensity. Vibrational polygon techniques. So now I draw a one more diagram. Let's I remove. I am already writing the value AB is equal to A, ABL is equal to theta. So let's I draw a polygon. This is R. I am defining this R by OM, OM, and this is the center of this R, and the radius of curvature, this K point K, and the radius of this curvature I define by R. This is the radius of curvature, R, center of this polygon, right, OM. Let's this point is L, and this total angle is 2 alpha. This total angle is 2 alpha. This angle is the same of this angle 2 alpha. Let's make the same angle 2 alpha with the horizontal line OP. Let's, this point is N. This point is N. So I can say M and P angle is 2 alpha. If this angle OKM is 2 alpha, then OKL angle will be only alpha, because this angle is 90 degree. This is the 90 degree angle. Right, so now I define all these parameters and try to find out the very first value of amplitude, and after the amplitude we calculate the value of intensity. So let's start. OM, this OM is A. OM is nothing but it's the width of the sleeve. This is the width of the sleeve, basically this is the width of the sleeve. So the arc corresponding to the width is defined by this arc OM. So the OM is equals to A, the width of a single sleeve. Width of single sleeve. Width of single sleeve. Right? So angle M and P. Angle M and P is equals to 2 alpha. This angle M and P is equals to 2 alpha. So this angle will be the same. OKM. So again, angle OKM have the same value. Both the angle have the same value. So in triangle OKL sine alpha will be equals to OL upon R. This sine alpha OL, this is 90 degree angle, this is alpha, then the sine will be OL divided by this value R. OK, OL by OK will be equals to sine alpha. Sine alpha is equals to OL by R. Therefore OL is equals to R sine alpha. The value of OL is R sine alpha. Now the value of OL is equals to R sine alpha. So what will be the value of OM? OM is nothing but it's a twice of OL. So OM is twice OL. Therefore this will be the 2R sine alpha. This is the value of OM. 2R sine alpha. 2R sine alpha. Right. What is OM? OM is this one. Now we derive a relation between this R, OM and this angle alpha. So now I remove this diagram. The length of the arc, length of arc OM is equals to K propagation constant multiplied by A. OM is equals to KA. The length of this arc. The length of this arc is KA. A is the width of this single sleeve. Right? So therefore 2 alpha, this angle, we know the relation between the angle and arc and radius is that angle is equals to 2 alpha, this is the angle 2 alpha is equals to arc OM upon radius. So the value of OM is equals to KA and radius is R. This angle theta is equals to 2 alpha is equals to R upon this radius. This is the well known relation between the angle and R. So 2 alpha is equal to r om divided by radius. So we know the value k alpha is equal to 2 alpha equals to k upon r. Therefore, I can write what will be the value of om. So in that case, the value of om is this is the om 2r sin alpha. So om is equals to, I can write therefore 2r is equals to ka upon alpha, ka upon alpha. So now I substitute the value of 2r in this expression, 2r into this expression. So the value of 2r is ka upon alpha sin alpha. Om equals to k sin alpha upon alpha. Now we have the relations of this r in terms of the width of the slit and the angle alpha, right? So but om is what? When we talk about the om, it's okay, the width of the this slit, but it's nothing but it's an amplitude. So I can write om is the amplitude. This is the amplitude. So now I give a new rotations. A is equals to ka upon alpha sin alpha. The amplitude ka sin alpha upon alpha. Or I can write a is equals to ka sin alpha by alpha. Sin alpha by alpha. Or I can use a naught sin alpha upon alpha. A naught maximum amplitude. A naught. So a is equals to k a sin alpha upon alpha. So this is the amplitude. So if we have the amplitude, we can easily find out the value of intensity. So the relations between the intensity and amplitude is that intensity I is proportional to alpha square. Intensity is equals to alpha square. So in that case, I will be equals to alpha not square, the square of this part, sin square alpha upon alpha square. Or I can write alpha naught sin alpha upon alpha whole square. So this is the derivation of intensity due to the single slit diffractions. It is the intensity of the diffraction due to the single slit. So this is the derivation of intensity due to single slit, right? Now alpha is the angle, this is the angle. So now we draw the intensity with respect to this angle alpha. So the point is very clear. We start from the vibrational polygon systems and we derive the value of amplitude, and after the value of amplitude we derive the formula of the intensity. Now we clearly say that intensity is depend on the angle alpha. So if I draw the intensity with respect to angle alpha, then the intensity curve will be this one. This is the intensity, this is angle alpha. So in the center part has maximum intensity, this is angle 0 pi, two 2 pi, 3 pi, and same minus pi, minus 2 pi, minus 3 pi. So this is the intensity distributions of a single slit diffraction. Now look at it. When angle is 0, the intensity is maximum. Now gradually the intensity is decreased. The intensity at pi plus pi by 2, 3 pi by 2 as small intensity compared to the center one. Again, the intensity is lower down the previous one. So now we mathematically derive the intensity at the point 0, at point 3 pi by 2, and so on. So let's the center maxima. This is the center maxima. So what will be the value of center maxima? If we have this relations I equals to I naught sine alpha upon alpha, then what will be the value of the center maxima? So I am writing first central maxima. This central maxima, if alpha tends to 0, if alpha tends to 0, in that case what will be the value of I? So put the value I naught sine 0 0 square. Now tell me what is the value of sine 0 by 0 form. The value of this part is 1. So in that case I will be I naught. That is the maximum intensity. Maximum intensity. Right? So we observe the maximum intensity when alpha is 0. Next, secondary maxima. This secondary maxima, this two secondary maxima. So second point, secondary maxima. Maxima. At what conditions we observe the secondary maxima? When alpha is equal to 2n plus 1 pi by 2, when this angle alpha has the value 2n plus 1 pi by 2, n may be 1, 2, 3, and so on. N is equal to 1, 2, 3, and so on. If we have this angle, we observe the secondary maxima. So let's consider n is equal to 1. So let's n is equal to 1. In that case, what will be the value of alpha? Alpha is 2 plus 1 by 2 pi, means 3 pi by 2, and alpha is 3 pi by 2. Calculate the value of intensity. So now we calculate the value of intensity when alpha is 3 pi by 2. So put the value of alpha equals to 3 pi by 2. I equals to I naught sine 3 pi by 2 divided by 3 pi by 2 square. Right? So I equals to I naught sine 3 pi by 2 divided by 3 pi by 2. Now the value of sine 3 pi by 2? Minus 1. So this is I naught minus 1 9 pi square by 4. 9 pi square by 4. So intensity I naught is equals to I equals to I naught upon 22. This is, when we solve these ones, if we multiply by 3.14 multiply 3.14, then we observe the intensity I equals to I naught by 22. This is the intensity of secondary maxima. This secondary maxima. So initially the primary maxima, the intensity is I naught, while the second is I naught by 22. It's a 1 upon 22 times of a primary intensity I naught. Right. Yes, next, when n is equal to 2, secondary second maximum, this is the secondary first maximum, now the secondary second maximum, basically it's a primary maximum. Now we have a different value, 3 pi by 2, at the value of 3 pi by 2 we observe secondary first maximum, at 5 pi by 2 we observe secondary second maximum. So when n is equal to 2, alpha will be, put the value n is equal to 2 in this expression. So this is 4 plus 1, 5 pi by 2. When n is equal to 2, alpha is 5 pi by 2. So now substitute the value 5 pi by 2 in this expression and calculate the value of intensity. So now we again put the value I is equal to I naught sin alpha is how much? 5 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2 divided by 5 pi by 2 square. So when we solve this one, I naught, this is 1, 5 pi by 2, or you can write 2 upon 5 pi, 2 upon 5 pi whole square, or 4 upon 25 pi I square. So if you do some more simplifications, so the value will be I naught upon 61, I naught upon 61. So initially the primary intensity is how much? I naught. Secondary first maximum intensity is I naught upon 22. Secondary second intensity is I naught upon 61. Both the sides. I naught upon 22. I naught upon 61. So we can clearly say by the mathematical proof that the intensity will be gradually decreased. And we increase the value of angle, the intensity will be gradually decreased in a single slit diffraction pattern. The last is secondary minima. This one, minima. These points are the minima. At what point we observe the minima? So we observe the minima at pi, 2 pi, and so on. So, right. Secondary minima. Secondary minima. So when angle is pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, and so on, n pi, calculate the value of intensity. So now we calculate the value of intensity. For this angle, I equals to I naught sin alpha upon alpha whole square. Put the value, first value I naught, alpha equals to pi. Alpha may be minus pi, minus 2 pi, minus 3 pi, and so on. Right? So put the value alpha equals to pi. So I equals to I naught sin pi upon pi 0. Now tell me, what is the value of sine pi? The value of sine pi is 0, so this will be 0. That means we can say the value of pi, the intensity is 0, which is represent the secondary minima, because it's the secondary, so secondary minima. Now we take the next angle, 2 pi. If you take minus pi, that means the secondary maxima minima in a left hand side, this secondary minima. Consider alpha equals to 2 pi. Consider alpha equals to 2 pi. So when alpha is 2 pi, I equals to I naught sine alpha upon alpha whole square I naught sine 2 pi upon 2 pi whole square. Now the value of sine 2 pi is 0, so again the value will be 0. So we can say all secondary minima will be 0 for the angle of pi, 2 pi, 3 pi and so on. So today we discuss about the intensity distributions of a single slit diffractions, and we clearly observe that the intensity is maximum at the center when angle is 0, the maximum intensity is I naught. If we have the angle 3 pi by 2, intensity is I naught by 22, and at the value of 5 pi by 2, the intensity is I naught upon 61. The same on the left hand side, when angle is minus 3 pi by 2, intensity is I naught upon 22, and when the angle is minus 5 pi by 2, intensity is I naught upon 61. That means we can say that intensity is gradually decrease when we increase the angle alpha. We observe the minimum intensity when angle is pi, 2 pi, 3 pi and so on, or the angle is minus pi, minus 2 pi or minus 3 pi. So here I stop it. Next we again continue this topic and find out the intensity of a double slit diffractions. Thank you.